One of the most popular technologies found in homes today for getting out to the internet and maybe connecting back to our main office using something we're going to be talking about called a VPN or a virtual private network is a cable modem. And a cable modem can use our television cable as the medium to get back to the internet. Many cable television companies today have a network that is composed of both fiber optics in some locations and then coaxial cables. And this infrastructure is called a hybrid fiber coax distribution network, or an HFC distribution network. And on this network, different frequency ranges are dedicated for different television channels, for one thing, but also for the transmission of data and the reception of data, upstream and downstream. And we can have a cable modem installed in our home that can listen on that range of frequencies dedicated to receiving data, and it can transmit on the range of frequencies dedicated to transmitting data. And those frequencies can vary. They often vary by country, but typically we see something like this. The upstream data frequencies range from 5 megahertz through 42 megahertz, and the downstream data frequencies range from 50 megahertz through 860 megahertz. Notice that there's a larger range of frequencies that we typically use for downstream. Most cable modem connections have higher bandwidth coming in than going back out to the internet. And this technology is a direct competitor with DSL that we talked about earlier. One of the advantages that DSL has is that your connection going back to the DSLAM is your connection. You're not sharing it with your neighbors. However, with a cable modem connection, you might be sharing your data bandwidth with your neighbors. Some people report that of an evening when more of their neighbors are home, their internet access speeds go down, and it's because they're having to share the bandwidth with their neighbors. However, on the good side, cable modems typically have more bandwidth available than DSL. Just a few years ago, it was common to max out your cable modem connection at a speed of 2 meg up and 10 meg down. However, today, in my home as an example, I have what my cable company calls a wideband connection. Not broadband, but wideband, because it has lots of extra bandwidth. Specifically, I'm getting 50 meg downstream coming in from the internet and 5 meg upstream going out to the internet. And these speeds are going to vary by carrier. They're going to vary by your location. Different countries set this up a little bit differently. And we mentioned that different frequency ranges were going to be used for data transmission and reception. There are actually specifications for this that say what frequencies can be used for what. And these specifications are called DOCSIS versions. DOCSIS, Data Over Cable Service Interface Specification. And different countries might have their own flavor of DOCSIS. For example, many European countries, they have their own set of frequency ranges, as specified in a standard known as EuroDOCSIS. Now let's sum up some of the characteristics of cable modems. This feature is widely available because so many people already have cable television coming into their home. This type of connection, even though we're going to be sharing bandwidth with our neighbors potentially, is generally going to have more bandwidth available than DSL connections, especially the common ADSL connections we find in homes. And we mentioned that different frequency ranges are going to be used for sending and receiving data, and these frequency ranges, they're defined in a DOCSIS standard. The next WAN technology we want to talk about is a VPN, a virtual private network. And the cool thing about a VPN is it can allow us to have a private conversation over an untrusted network like the internet. So a VPN actually gets established over your internet connection. At least it can work that way. Let's take a look at a few benefits of a VPN. Number one, like we just said, we can use existing broadband technologies that we may already have in our home or small office, like DSL or cable. And this is a very scalable solution because if we need to add on a new client, a new site, that client or that site, they just need internet access and then they can connect back to us at the main site. Of course, that main site that we're connecting into, whatever we're using as a VPN concentrator there, maybe a Cisco ASA, an adaptive security appliance, maybe a Cisco router, it has to have capacity to handle all of these incoming VPN sessions. But that's about it. And thirdly, as we mentioned, we are able to securely transmit data over an untrusted network like the internet. This is one of the reasons years ago people would use frame relay, or they would have a leased line connection between two sites because they didn't want to send that traffic over the public public internet. It was private. It was confidential information. However, now we have the ability to protect information flowing over that VPN. And Cisco gives us two broad categories of VPNs. Number one, we have a site-to-site VPN. That's what we have here. We've got location A, we've got location B, and we have the routers at each site, or these could be adaptive security appliances, but here I've got routers at each site that are acting as the endpoints in this VPN. In other words, this connection is totally transparent to the end user. We don't have to load up any special VPN client software on our PC. No, we just go to the router, and the router is going to encrypt the traffic and send it over a VPN tunnel over to the other router. Another type of VPN that we have is a remote access VPN. A remote access VPN is where the PC or the device connecting into the VPN, that's where the authentication is going to be done. We've got a couple of options that use SSL, Secure Sockets Layer. With one option, we do not have to install any special client software on the PC. We can just use our web browser, and using HTTPS, we're going to be able to connect to a website, maybe back at the main office, to give us access to that main office's network. This is called a clientless Cisco SSL VPN. Maybe you're visiting a public library and you need to securely get back into your office. Well, this is an option for doing that. Another option is to install some client software on that device. Maybe you install the Cisco AnyConnect SSL VPN software. And for years, here's what I've been running. I've been running the Cisco VPN client on my machine to get back to my corporate office. But the bottom line is we have different VPN client options. Your operating system may come with a VPN client. But let's talk for a moment about the actual technology that is going to secure communication between these sites. The most popular way of doing this is to use something called IPsec, which is short for IP security. Let's discuss IPsec in a bit more detail. Let's see how easy it is to create a GRE tunnel between these two routers. Notice that we've got IP addresses assigned to the physical interfaces already. 10.1.1.1 on router R1, 10.1.1.2 on router R2. What we're going to do is define a virtual interface on each of these routers, a virtual tunnel interface. Here's how this works. Let's go into global configuration mode, and let's just create, out of thin air, a virtual tunnel interface. I'm going to say interface tunnel, and we give it a number. I'll just say tunnel 1, and we say who's the source. I'll say tunnel source is going to be the IP address of the serial 1/0 interface. It's going to be 10.1.1.1, and I'll say what's the destination. It's going to be the far side of that serial link. The tunnel destination is going to be 10.1.1.2. Now, since I'm in this interface configuration mode, I need to assign an IP address to this interface. It's going to be on a different subnet. I'm going to say that this tunnel interface has an IP address of 172.16.1.1 with a 30-bit subnet mask. Let's go do the same thing on router R2, just pointing back in the other direction. On router R2, let's go into interface tunnel 1. And we'll say the tunnel source is the IP address on this router, 10.1.1.2, and we'll say the tunnel destination is the other side, 10.1.1.1. Let's assign an IP address. It's going to be on the same subnet as the IP address we assigned over on router R1. Let's make it 172.16.1.2 with a 30-bit subnet mask. And we're done. It's that easy to create a tunnel. Let's make sure we have connectivity across this tunnel. Can I ping the tunnel interface on R1? Let's try. Ping 172.16.1.1. Yes, I can. That is successful. Let's give a couple of show commands also to confirm this configuration. If I do a show IP interface brief, we see that this virtual tunnel interface is showing up side by side with our physical interfaces. It's in the up-up state, and I can do a show interfaces tunnel 1 to see more specific information about it. For example, I can see that we're using GRE encapsulation. That's what we said is a good combination to use with IPsec. And we can also see the tunnel source and destination. Well, that's going to wrap up our video, which gave us an introduction to virtual private networks, VPNs.